beginning this new ministry season and this new series called Come and See. There's this passage, these passages throughout the Gospel of John that use this terminology, and we're going to look at a few of them over the next coming weeks. Today, our scripture reading comes from John chapter 1, verses 35 through 39 and 43 through 50. I'll invite you to stand out of reverence for the gospel. Hear this word this morning. The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law spoke about in the law and also in the prophets, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." And Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" And Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." And Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. And as you're seated this morning, I'll invite you to pray with me. And gracious God, as we open your word, we pray that you would open our hearts, that we might follow you into discipleship, that we might be willing to invite others to come and see what you're doing in our lives and in this place. Pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, one of the things that we do is we gather around this table to share in communion. And in our tradition in the United Methodist Church, we practice what's called an open table, which means that everyone is invited to the table. Doesn't matter if you're a member of this church or a member of any church, you are invited. Doesn't that feel good in some way? To know that you're invited. Invitations are important in our lives. I had a conversation with a young man the other day preparing to get married, and we were talking about wedding invitations, and it made me think about my own wedding and about this moment in time where we were preparing for it. We were making all the decisions that had to be made, and I remember at one point this conversation that Michelle and I had. I use the term conversation very loosely in this moment. She held up two pieces of paper, and she said, "We need to decide which invitation we want. Which one do you like better?" I said, "The white one." She said, "They're both white." And I said, "I know." She said, "But they're different shades of white, and this is very important." I said, "The white one." And she said, no, seriously. And I said, honestly, sweetheart, I don't care. Almost 20 years later, I know I was wrong. I know that I had made the wrong choice in that moment. I knew immediately almost that I had made the wrong choice. She got visibly upset, to the point of tears even, and said, "This is really important. These invitations are going out to people that we love and care about, inviting them to come to the most important day of our lives." Those invitations were important. Invitation in general is important. We love to be invited different places. My kids love getting invited to go and do things. They love getting invited to birthday parties and different things like that. I don't necessarily love it when they get invited to birthday parties. It means I've got to go to Chuck E. Cheese, which, I pray for Chuck E. Cheese all the time. It's a tough place. But we love getting invited different places. We love hearing invitations, and we love to tell others about opportunities for them to be invited to something we really care about. We love telling people about different restaurants that we go to and different things that we experience, and we really enjoy inviting them to come along or inviting them to experience the same good experience that we had. But then when it comes to church, this funny thing happens. See, this recent poll found that 86% of people said if they were invited to church, they would come. And yet, across America, worship attendance is down. So there must be some disconnect between our desire or our ability to invite other people and the reality of that happening. And I think it's tough for us sometimes. It really is. We're worried when we extend an invitation to somebody to come to church. We're not sure exactly what to say. We're not sure exactly how to phrase it. We're not sure how to go about it because they might ask some other questions. If I invite someone to church, what if they want to know what we believe about this or that or the other? What if they want to know about the creation story or about the resurrection? What if they want to know what we think about this issue or that issue? What if they ask some questions and I don't have all the answers? I think this is the biggest barrier between us inviting people to be here and not. Because I know you care about this place. I know that you're invested in this place. I know that you love being here because you're here. On a rainy Sunday morning, you are here. This place has made an impact. And your faith has made an impact in your life in some way or another. And I think all we really need is some new verbiage, some ways to talk about invitation that allows us to have the freedom to say, I'd love for you to be there, without having to explain all that goes along with it. I think Jesus gives us a way of talking about this in the first chapter of John. When he calls the first disciples, this is the way that John tells us this story. John the Baptist sees Jesus coming by and he says to some of his disciples, some of his followers, here comes the Lamb of God. And so they start following Jesus. Not like their followers, like disciples, they're just following him physically, which Jesus notices. And he turns around and he says, what are you looking for? What are you looking for? What a profound question to ask two people who are just following you on the road. What are you looking for? I think it's a question that all of us in some way, shape, or form are asking. What are you looking for? The Greek literally means, what are you seeking? What are you trying to find in life? What are you trying to get out of life? A lot of us would answer that in a lot of different ways. Maybe we're just trying to get to the next promotion. Maybe we're just trying to get to the day when our kids go back to school. Maybe we're just trying to get to retirement. Maybe we're just trying to get to the moment when the kids all leave the house and don't come back again. What are you looking for? What are you seeking in life? This is a question that we should all be asking as we walk into this place, and it's one that I think that we all ask in some way or another, but Jesus asked these disciples, and they aren't sure how to respond. They don't know what to say, so they say, where are you staying at? Where are you staying at, Jesus? We'd like to see where you're staying. we'd like to spend a little bit more time with you. We'd like to get to know you. We're not totally sure that we're ready to answer this question the way that you might want us to answer this question, but we'd like to know you a little bit better. So where are you staying at? I love going into people's homes. I love when I get invited to people's houses because I get to go in and I get to see some of the things that are important to them. I get to learn about them. I get to experience a little bit of their world. I get to see what pictures they've hung on the wall, what art is important to them, what really matters. And so these disciples go with Jesus and they spend the day with him where he's staying. And they get to experience a little bit more of who he is and what he's inviting them to and how they might live their lives. So much so that they begin to follow him. There's something about experiencing Jesus that moves us beyond what we think we have to do. See, most of us think that we have to explain Jesus. But what we're invited to in this scripture is to remind people that they can come and experience Jesus. It's kind of like when I get home in the afternoon. You know, come home from work and you walk in the house and the kids have built some sort of fort out of blankets and sheets, or they've made something out of Legos, or this summer they've spent a lot of more time on the Nintendo thing than probably I wanted them to, but hey, it kept them busy. And they were designing these new Mario levels on the Nintendo Switch, and so I'd come home and they'd say, Dad, come and see what we did today. And my first instinct is generally like, I just need a minute. Like, I just need a minute of time to calm down, to decompress. I get bombarded when I walked in there, come and see. But I have to remind myself, this is important to them. This is how we experience things together. And so I'll go with them and they'll show me this and they'll show me that. And they'll tell me, and I'll ask questions. I want to understand how to get in and out of the fort. I want to understand how to not die on the Mario level every time. Because that's how they designed it, so that I would not do well at it. Which is kind of, why do they got to be like that? But I get to experience something with them. Sometimes in the church we use this word evangelism, and it scares us a little bit. When we hear the word evangelism, we're kind of put off. We're kind of not sure how to feel about it. We're worried that somebody's going to invite us to go door to door or to stand out on the street corner with a megaphone and a sign. But evangelism is really just about sharing good news. That's what that word is, euangelion in the Greek, the good news. We get to invite people to experience good news, to experience Jesus. But we think it's like that old program at school, you know, Tell and Tell. Didn't you guys enjoy Tell and Tell? Where people just got up and talked and told all the things. No, we didn't like that. We like show and tell. We like to see something and experience it and really engage it and look at it and just be there, be present with it. We loved show and tell. We loved an invitation to engage something real. To move beyond tell and tell. The reality is that Jesus doesn't need to be explained. Jesus needs to be experienced. The goal is not to explain something, but to experience someone. Jesus says, come and see, come and experience this. And the disciples pick up on this. They see this happening. And so as we read further in the story, we see Philip go to Nathanael and go, hey, Nathanael, you've got to come and see this guy, Jesus. This guy, Jesus, we found the one who the Old Testament scriptures write about. It's Jesus of Nazareth. And I love Nathanael in this scripture because he's kind of the sarcastic cynic. Right? Nathaniel goes, Nazareth. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? That podunk town? Come on. Come on, don't feed me that line. I'm not going to see Nazareth. And I love Philip's response. Philip doesn't go, well, let me tell you why Jesus came from Nazareth, and let me open the scriptures, and let me tell you everything from the Old Testament. Let me talk you through this. Let me tell you and tell you and tell you. No, no, no. Philip just says, why don't you come and see? Just come and see. As Jesus sees Nathanael coming to him, he says, look at this guy. Here comes an Israelite with no deceit. In other words, here comes somebody who's being honest about where they're at in life, about their questions, about their struggles, about their doubts, about their brokenness. This is a person with no deceit. This is a person who's coming to see just as they are. And Jesus celebrates this reality. Come and see. And Jesus says, oh, did you believe because I said I saw you under the fig tree? That's fine. But you're going to experience even greater things than these. Like we're sitting in this room today, most of us, because we've experienced someone, the person of Jesus. At some point in our lives, someone invited us to come and to see, to move beyond just showing up and to engage in a way that moved us outside of just trying to explain something to the point that we experienced someone. Someone invited us to come and to see a VBS or VBX. Somebody invited us to come and see some sort of youth programming. Somebody invited us to come and see a Bible study. Somebody invited us to come and see a worship experience that moved us beyond what we could explain to a place where we experienced Jesus. What would it look like for us to extend that same sort of invitation? God is doing some amazing things in and through this church. The Spirit is empowering amazing ministry to take place. Would you be willing to invite someone to come and see?